it's constantly changing, how can I be sure where I stand with you? Whenever I'm away from you.
He was the first pop idol I ever remember trying to imagine naked. And I was only like 8.
How can I be sure in a world that's constantly changing?
David Cassidy was definitely my first love. Most definitely.
Where I stand with you.
He did pack him in. Girls were passing out all the time, and he was really a heartthrob.
Cherish is the word I use to describe.
You just ate, slept, dreamt David Cassidy.
I write the songs that make those young girls cry.
Every day people come up to me and tell me that I made a difference in their life. It's the greatest gift that anyone could ever have.
I'm sleeping and right in the middle of a good
Las Vegas, showbiz capital of America. A former teen idol steps back into the spotlight.
Fantastic performer. I mean, obviously
you're drawing in the crowd.
Oh, it's wonderful, wonderful. This is the best of my life.
What a comeback. It's great to see him back.
I think I love you. I am a clown.
Here's a little background for you folks at home on the Cassidy family. Jack Cassidy, Broadway star, marries Evelyn Ward, Broadway star. They have David Cassidy. Jack and Evelyn divorce sometime in the mid-50s. Jack meets Shirley Jones, doing a European tour of Oklahoma. Sparks fly. They get married, and David feels very much outside the family. And my dad was kind of a distant figure to him.
I remember being a kid, so insecure. I'm thinking about it again, you know, getting choked up about it, because here you're a child, and you don't know. The universe revolves around you and your parents. My parents were always gone. They were always not around me. They were actors.
You know, I never changed.
I was a guy who was very much a part of my generation. I had already smoked pot, and before I became a serious actor, I was sneaking out at night, and I cut school all the time, and I got kicked out of high schools. I wasn't a bad boy, I was just wild.
I don't want to go to school.
You told me you don't want to go to school. You told me until my head's ready to spin. Now your pa says you're going, and that's final.
He ain't my pa.
After behaving badly in Bonanza and Ironside, in 1970, Cassidy was cast as a clean-cut, all-American boy.
Ladies and gentlemen, America's latest success story, The Partridge Family.
Come on now and meet everybody.
David's own stepmother, Shirley Jones, was hired as his screen mum, with David playing heartthrob Keith. The series also featured teen model Susan Day and 11-year-old Danny Bonaducci. Dave Madden played the band's long-suffering manager.
Five of us and Mom working all day. We knew we could help her if our music would pay.
Okay. Begin with Vito at the top of the scene. And action!
You know, The Partridge Family was a series about a widow whose husband obviously died of exhaustion and a natural lack of rhythm, leaving behind all these kids that look nothing like their mother or each other. Did you ever notice that?
It's one of those nights when you turn out the lights and you sit in the dark and say to yourself, I miss her. It's one of those moods when your body broods and you conjure up her picture and you kiss her. One of those things for the pain it brings. You say to yourself, hey, couldn't I live without it?
There was somebody for everybody.
Well, I think so. On the other hand, I doubt it.
But the little redhead
one. Except for
one.
Fat Danny.
No, it was Danny's very popular now.
Dave Madden, the guy who played Reuben Kincaid, told me very early on how they picked us.
Howdy, little.
This is a showdown.
He came to me, and I was all of 10 years old, and he said, well, they'd hired Shirley Jones and David Cassidy and Susan Day. They really needed a couple of ugly people, so they got us.
When I get out in front of the cameras, do you think I'll forget about it?
I doubt it.
I obviously just used to think he was gorgeous. The whole Partridge Family thing made you feel like, yeah, he could be your brother, or, you know, he could be the boyfriend. He was the one that you would love to be the guy who knocked on the door and said, would you like to come out to the pictures?
Starring Cassidy, the series realistically promoted the Partridges as a single-parent family turned hit pop act. Their debut single sold 5 million.
And right in the middle of a good dream, like all at once I wake up from something that keeps knocking at my brain. Before I go insane, I hold my pillow to my head and spring up in my bed, screaming out the words I dread. I think I love you.
This morning I woke up with this feeling I didn't know how to deal with.
And so I just decided to myself I'd hide it to myself and never talk about it, and did not go and shout it when you walked into the room.
I think I love you.
And that's it.
Shirley.
I think I love you.
I think I love you. So what am I so afraid of?
Have you watched the musical numbers? I'm barely in them. I didn't learn the words. It took me, I think, about 5 episodes of the show when David Cassidy finally came to me and said, hey man, you don't strum a bass, you pluck it.
She's my girl of the things she'll like to do. Like walking in the rain.
David sang. Shirley went doo-ah, doo-ah in the background so she could make money on the albums. I wanted to hum. They wouldn't let me. I'd like to have had some of that money too, but they wouldn't let me do that.
I guess from television, and that the rest of the kids in the show and the people in the show couldn't really play, that people were surprised that I could actually play.
Mom, I wish you wouldn't stuff your ears every time we play. It's very discouraging.
Can I help it if I'm a music lover?
I like to say that the Partridge Family was the original Milli Vanilli, but at least the Milli Vanilli tried.
We got a sound that'll knock your eyeballs out.
Yeah, I'm sure you have.
I think that they had some damn good pop songs. Some were really bad, but a lot of them had the basic things you need in pop: a catchy chorus, simple romantic lyrics.
They say that breaking up is hard to do.
To do. Now I know that it's true.
Don't say that this is the end.
Instead of breaking up, I wish that we were making up again.
The first time that I knew we're famous, we're at a parade in Cleveland, Ohio. Oh, it was insane. There's a parade where they had the biggest crowd ever was 50,000 people. Partridge Family was so huge, they brought in security for 100,000 people. 500,000 people showed up. And we were on a fire engine, which got flipped over. Susan Day's clothes were ripped off like that. David Cassidy had chunks of his hair either cut off or just ripped out. And I thought, hey man, we're famous.
Give me a C! Give me an A! Give me an S! Give me an S!
Launched as a solo star, in 1972, Cassidy fever spread to Britain.
What would you do, Teresa, if you had the chance to meet David Cassidy in the flesh?
I don't think I'll be able to say anything. I think I'd be too nervous. No. You just don't expect to meet him personally. And if you did, you know.
Hi there. Hi there.
I didn't want to be famous. For me, the ambition was really about doing something that made me tick, that made me the juices flow. And that was acting, that was writing, that was singing, that was performing.
Don't know how many times I wish that I had told you. You don't know how many times I wish that I could hold you. know how many times I wish that I could mold you into someone who could cherish me as much as I cherish you.
I remember the stage outfits when he was out on the road, where he was working some polyester full-body suits,
yeah,
which were very different from what he wore on the TV, which was kind of regular guy gear, jeans and
shirts. Do you know who else wore polyester body suits?
Apart from me?
Elvis.
David definitely had a difficult time with his image as Keith Partridge, as being everybody's older brother, and as being a goody-two-shoes.
Keith, the whole neighborhood is so proud of you. Going off to Hollywood to be a big movie star.
I may not even get the part.
With that face, how could they refuse?
People were always shocked when they would see, like, David Bowie and Iggy Pop and David Cassidy and Mickey Dolenz. You know, we respected David. David could sell out, you know, Dodger Stadium a couple times, and that gives you a lot of respect.
And one more thing before I let you go. And I woke up in love this morning.
David was a normal 19, 20-year-old guy that was like all of us. Our hormones are in our tennis shoes, and the number one thing that you think about all the time is women.
Oh, God. Oh, it just sounds, he looks at, oh, it's just great. Oh, it's beautiful.
It's kind of why people become musicians, right? Don't they say that's why they pick up a guitar, is to meet girls, you know? So here he was, in a wonderful situation to do that. And even though he couldn't even leave the hotel to look for them, he had people to bring them up there to him. All nicely chaperoned, of course, you know, but by me, with my camera.
He just sends you mad. He's so good looking, he's not true, you know? Everybody wants to get near him.
Could it be forever? Or is my mind just rambling on? I touched you once, I kissed you once, now I feel like mine.
Everybody only saw his nice, squeaky clean 16 magazine cover, but Dave was a party animal. Yeah.
Hey, it was a wild and free and wonderful environment, and I was like every other red-blooded American boy.
Could it be forever? Or am I just a waste of time?
I had as much of an appetite for all of it as everybody else did.
Well, girls were passing out all the time, and he was really a heartthrob.
And I can't remember when the feelings have been stronger. And all I know is I can't let go on a few.
What's your ambition as far as he's concerned?
Oh, like me and 1,000 of other girls in the world, most probably to become Mrs. David Cassidy.
And we all kind of sat around going, gee, I wish we kind of had that. Girls, you know, passing out. But they passed out at our concerts for all different reasons, though.
Keith, I've got something to tell you.
What?
You know that rumor about me and the older woman? Every word of it's true.
But you're only 10.
I actually lost my virginity on the set of The Partridge Family to a David Cassidy fan. I was 13. She must have been 22, 25. And she was looking all over David, and I guess he had his film of girls in the dressing room, of which there were who knows how many. And I just went up to her all at 13 years old, and I said, "Hi, I'm Danny." And apparently, any partridge in a storm was her motto, and I like to say I gave that woman the best 30 seconds of her life.
I was a huge David Cassidy fan. It's true to say probably that he was the first man that I probably fell in love with.
I love you!
He was a fabulous mover, and his cute little bum on action and stage was something I will not forget. It was gorgeous.
In the eyes of the world, being born was my first big mistake.
To be at the focal point of all of that energy of people screaming, I love you. I wish every human could feel it.
The eyes of my woman, I stand.
I remember waking up in New Zealand. I mean, it was very early in the morning, and outside the room, the window, you hear this, you know, we love you, David. We always will. We love you. And oh, my God.
When
one person looks at you and says, I love you, and they look at you and they say, no, 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 I love you. I love you. I love you. I love you. When 20, 30, 40, 50,000 people screaming at the top of their lungs, I love you. It's so overwhelming, man. It's like, whoa. You know, it's the ultimate e-ticket.
A millionaire pop idol at 22, David was the world's most eligible bachelor. He drove his female fans wild and began to live in fear of being torn apart.
It was just mass hysteria. I couldn't walk down the street. I couldn't go anywhere. I couldn't stay in hotels. I had to stay on a boat in the Thames, for instance, in London. I mean, in New York, I couldn't stay in any hotel.
David's schedule, looking back on it now, was almost inhuman. I mean, I think the labor board would probably come down on us. I mean, fortunately, he was over 18 because we would definitely be breaking child labor laws.
I'd get up at 6 in the morning, be there all day on the set of The Partridge Family, then I'd go and record at night until midnight, get home at 1 o'clock, get up at 6 o'clock, and on the weekends, I would go out and do concerts all over the place. So I never slept. I was always exhausted.
I have almost no voice left, you know? And my legs and my body's really, really sore, you know? I've just been done too many shows in just a short a period.
Always looked like I was hungover, which I wasn't, because I didn't drink, I didn't smoke, I didn't take no drugs, no alcohol, no nothing. I couldn't possibly maintain if I was doing that, working that much.
The pressures of television and constant touring were already taking their toll.
I never saw my home. I saw it between 1 in the morning and 6 in the morning. That was it.
Yet the demand for David was insatiable. For over 2 years, he would be every schoolgirl's fantasy. He even looked good in cheesecloth. And there was more to him than just the dreamboat image. Oh, what a voice.
It was very breathy. How can I be sure? It's all sort of very breathy, not so much vibrato, but breathy. And that was his distinctive sound, more than anything else.
Whenever I'm away from you, I wanna die.
And I actually remember listening to the countdown on the top 20 on Radio 1, and How Can I Be Sure is number one. I remember bursting into tears, like, you've made it, David, you've made it.
How can I be sure in a world that's constantly changing? How can I be sure where I stand with you? Whenever I'm away from you, I wanna die, 'cause you know I wanna stay with you. How do I know? Maybe you're trying to use me. Touch me, but don't take me down.
Is a sexual experience for them all. For me too, you know? And it could become a burlesque show, you know? I mean, really, I mean, if I were to carry it further, I could have just, you know, I mean, anybody can come out and really carry it all the way. It's just a matter of saying, okay, I mean, this is where we're gonna go, and this is where we draw the line, kids, you know?
Maybe I'm just hanging around with my head upside down, it's a pity. Can't seem to find someone who's as pretty and lovely as you.
I'd be lying if I told you I wasn't aware that people were attracted to me, men, women. But most of it is very innocent.
I could feel your heartbeat, and you didn't even say a word.
He had something about him. For lack of a better word, he was very cocky. When you're,
do you remember how his hair used to walk in a room with that?
Yeah, and
confident
it used to
hair.
We used to love that confident hair.
And I was desperate to have straight hair so I'd be able to have that style. In fact, I don't know. Maybe now. Maybe it's somewhere here,
is the David Cassidy hairstyle. That's a bit frightening, isn't it?
You can feel my heartbeat too. I can tell you're feeling me. You can feel my heartbeat too. I can see you feeling me. Oh, I know, pretty woman, that you love to be hurt.
Cassidy was big business. You could stick David's face on absolutely anything and it would sell in truckloads.
Jackie was the little girl's Bible. If there was a picture of David Cassidy on the front, or there was a floppy disk of maybe his latest single or something that he'd recorded specially for the magazine, of course you'd buy it. And probably, you know, the day after publication, there'd be none on the shelves.
I had lunch boxes. I had a thermos.
So
I had
money.
A toothbrush.
Love, love, I could be your heartbeat. Love, love.
Pillowcase. I had a pillowcase. I mean, if I had these things now, they are collector's items, and they should be. They were awesome moments in tech. Awesome.
One of my favorites is the pendant radio, and you would wear it around your neck on a chain, and I love it because the girl who owned it originally had her picture next to David's. And it's just kind of cute to see, well, that's who was in love with David back then.
I'm aware of the impact that I had on the world and on the planet. I have to be. I'd be completely and totally unconscious if I didn't. A, I was living it then, and B, I'm David Cassidy today. I walk down the street, or I go anywhere, I play here, and people are constantly telling me what an impact I had on their lives.
Now is it my body, or something I might be?
Despite the clean-cut Keith Partridge image, in private, David Cassidy lived the rock and roll lifestyle alongside his pal Alice Cooper. But strangely, sex and drugs weren't the real taboo of the day.
He said something to me backstage, like, so I said, so what are you going to do afterwards? And he said, well, we're going so-and-so, but I got a golf game tomorrow morning. And I went, excuse me?
I hit more fairways with it. I hit it longer. You get it in your hands and you just know you're going to smack that ball. In rock and roll terms, it's a killer club.
Golf now has become a very acceptable rock and roll thing to do. And we were playing golf when we had to be closet golfers.
Now this is fun.
We were kind of rebels at the time. We'd get in disguise and go out and play golf. Mickey Dolenz played golf too. Iggy Pop played golf. But we couldn't talk about it. It was like, you know, I mean, you could talk about anything, sexually, drug-wise, anything like that you could talk about, but never mention golf. It was like a suicidal thing to mention golf at that time.
Rolling Stone wanted to write an article about him. I think probably, you know, he wanted to sort of influence the article kind of away from the Partridge Family and more onto what he was trying to do as a solo performer.
The cover of the Rolling Stone,
yeah,
where he was, I assume, virtually naked. I mean, you can almost see his pubic hair. If he had any, he was probably just getting it.
It was just suicide. Nothing, well, actually it was murder, because he was killing Keith. Really? Ooh, how profound. But that's exactly what that was. He was doing what he could to kill Keith, and to everyone's surprise.
Nothing in the world could bother me, 'cause I was living in a world of ecstasy. But now you're gone, I'm just a daydreamer.
The impact was with the television show and the sponsors, and they were freaking out.
It was the fastest and largest selling edition ever until the death of John Lennon.
Well, I was taking photos of the Osmond brothers, and I showed it to Donnie and his brothers, and they all kind of crowded around looking, going, oh my God, you know, look at that. I mean, these guys were Mormons and pretty squeaky clean, you know, and they were shocked.
I find myself alone with only memories of you.
It was the most controversial, because the article itself made reference at one point to there being pot, and the way it was written was, it could have been me, which it wasn't. And I resented the fact that they tried to, in any way, tarnish or create an illusion that I was the antithesis of this squeaky clean white guy.
People that actually read it and didn't like David Cassidy still liked Keith. He couldn't kill the guy.
There was a big apology in Tiger Beat with him hanging his head and photographs and explaining why he said it. It was scandalous to me when I was young. I felt very betrayed.
Daydreamer, I'm walking in the rain.
chasing after rainbows I may never find again. Life is much too beautiful to live it all alone. Oh, how much I need someone to call my very own.
I can warm your coldest night. I'll make everything alright. Come on, ooh, rock me, baby. Let me feel that beat. I said, ooh, rock me, baby. Right down to my feet. I said, ooh, rock me, baby. Hold me oh so tight. I said, ooh, rock me, baby, rock me through the night. You better hold me while you can, or you're gonna lose your midnight man. Now come on and rock me.
By early 1974, the level of teenage hysteria at Cassidy's concerts was causing concern. Venues and hotels banned him. Exhausted, David had already decided to retire after one last tour. At the front line, even his security guard supported the decision.
I've just been bitten, you know, bitten and punched and everything else like that. I've got big bruises on my arm, like what they've done, you know, these young kids, these young gentle girls.
And there'd be screaming, you know, screams and screams and girls jumping up and down, crying and, you know, screaming hysterically. You've heard this shrill kind of a thing, you could hardly hear the music.
My concerts didn't become a musical event, they became an event. How the media would perceive the event. It became such a hassle, and I remember that Beatles had the same problem. You know, that's why they stopped touring, they couldn't do it anymore. And it's one of the reasons why I had to stop. You know, I played Melbourne Cricket Grounds to 65,000 people, the Houston Astrodome to 60,000 people.
I'd say halfway into the Partridge Family, you could see that the workload was just too much. And he went another 2 years after that with the Partridge Family. And unfortunately, he was burnt out at that point.
It's difficult to look yourself in the eye after a while. You know, you wake up in the morning and you say, well, good morning, teen idol, or whatever it is, you know. It's difficult. It takes a tremendous toll on you, I think, emotionally.
And I announced, this is it. And I remember hearing the cynics going, oh yeah, he'll be back like David Bowie every year, you know, he'll be back next year. He's just doing it to sell tickets. And I said, no, honestly, this is it. I can't do it anymore. I cannot continually perpetuate this thing. It's become the burden of being this famous and being this successful and having this kind of, you know, entourage to have to go anywhere is becoming, I've lost my own identity.
To be honest with you, I've been touring about, I guess, three and a half years. And I'm really tired. Perhaps sometime I'll come back and do it again, but it won't be as the David Cassidy as we know him today, you know.
Cassidy hoped to leave on a high note, but in May, on his farewell tour, he performed before a crowd of 60,000 screaming schoolgirls at London's White City.
If I didn't care, can't say if I didn't care.
It was very crowded very early on, and I took one look at the crowd. It was just really pushing forward, pushing forward.
So while all the singing was going on and the band was playing and David was running around singing, I was looking down and seeing these girls being, you know, hoisted out bodily from the front of the stage and sort of carried off.
And what makes my head go round and round while my heart stands still?
The concert was insane. There were so many hundreds and hundreds of people being pulled out. Seeing people screaming and crying because they're being crushed.
Tony Blackburn was comparing, and he went to the front of the stage, the concert stopped, and said, look, it will not go on unless everybody takes three paces backwards.
You can't control 60,000 screaming teenagers. You can't.
More than 100 little girls lying out on stretchers backstage, and they were just coming and coming and coming, and it was a really horrible experience.
Caught in the crush, 14-year-old Bernadette Whelan from South London suffered a heart attack. She died 4 days later.
got to a point where I couldn't handle anymore. I was almost numb. You'll see a guy who looks pretty numb, probably. Probably pretty scared, probably pretty frightened, very burnt out, exhausted, and confused. How did this happen? How did I get here? I did not personally act irresponsibly, nor did the security men, nor did the ambulances and anybody else involved. I think that it just was a situation. She wasn't in the front. I don't think she was injured. She was on the sides. And I think just from the excitement of it all, so I've been told, and there have been a lot of rumors about it, she just had, a heart attack.
It really let us know that this has to stop the way it's going now. And it was a very sobering experience.
Despite the White City tragedy, Cassidy's final performance went ahead in Manchester. For security reasons, he arrived disguised as a St. John's ambulance man. But many parents kept their daughters away. Although only 24, it was David's last concert for a decade. Guess I never took the time to tell you how much I love you. Oh, you and the road keep flashing through my mind.
It was very emotional for me. I remember when I was running off to get into the helicopter, running across the field, I remember thinking, this is it. I'll never do this again. I felt this weight as I was running off the field. I felt myself getting lighter and lighter and lighter.
David was completely exhausted and lost. Just wanted to, you know, go home and lock the door. The audience, again, you know, and the frenzy involved with a young pop star is short term. If you're going to go long term, you've got to find something else to tap into in the audience besides how cute you look on a poster. Is there something that I can do?
Am I losing you? While I was walking down the street, the neighbors started booing. Booing me? Do you know what that does for my ego?
Your ego could use a little booing.
The Partridge Family lasted, I believe, 4.5 years. I think we did 96 episodes. I don't think David could go on. Not only could he not keep up the hours, but he couldn't keep up the pretense of being Keith Partridge and didn't want to.
Mom, is there something you wanted to talk to me about?
No.
Susan Day went on to star in L.A. Law, while Shirley Jones returned to her first love, stage musicals.
Because if it's true, then I think we should relax for 6 months and use that time to take a hard look at what we're doing.
After overcoming drug addiction, Danny Bonaducci became a stand-up comedian and radio DJ.
It is in fact Chevy Chase. How you doing, man?
Hey, you're going on vacation.
I am out. I used to say that you know your career is over when you do the Love Boat, and I did it twice. And then it dropped me off at Fantasy Island, and then boom, I was done.
Why me?
I thought it was going to be a lot greater than it was. You know, I thought, boy, wouldn't it be great for everybody to know who you are? And I decided very quickly, no, that's not great at all. Fame is a prison. It's a prison that the more famous you are, the smaller your world becomes. And that's not any fun. It's a tricky
situation. Having abandoned live performance, David Cassidy concentrated on recording, hoping to woo a more mature audience. Chase love shadows till the rivers run cold. But hey, babe, get it up. It's a tricky situation. Hard to say just what the outcome would be. If you solve the riddle, you can save the soul. Chase some shadows till the rivers run cold.
I was never able to reveal David Cassidy. I was never able to sit down and tell you exactly who and what I feel about something. That was never ever done or ever accomplished. They kept me from doing that. I was never able to write and record the kind of songs I wanted to do. And as an artist, I just felt very, 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 very sort of confined.
after the international touring was over, he kind of got into recording. You know, he made several albums. The first one was The Harder They Climb. We had him sort of reaching up, you know, holding onto like a rope with his guitar, and on the back was going to be the picture, The Harder They Fall. And so we did this shot in an alley, and him as a drunken bum, being the actor that he is, he was able to really make this look real. The record company was horrified. They wouldn't let us use it. We had to shoot the suit that he wore on the front. We had to shoot that laying on the ground with lots of girls' feet standing around as if he'd fallen.
Shortly after that, about a year or so after that, my father died. And I call this time really the dark period of my life. I began drinking.
David had, you know, the challenge of not speaking to him in the last year or two. And that's a rough one for him, and I know that.
We didn't talk for the last 9 months of his life. The more famous I became, the more my father resented me. And all I really wanted him to do was put his arms around me and tell me he loved me. And the more I did to make him proud of me, the more it alienated him from me.
There was a certain tragedy that really went along with a competition between him and his father. So I think that had a lot to do with his drinking and, you know, where he went from there. Then when you realized that the show was over and he wasn't really making records and he kind of disappeared, then you knew there was something wrong. You know, same with me. When I kind of like disappeared for a while, everybody knew that I was either going to come back healthy or I wasn't going to come back. You know, and that's really what the two choices you have. Either you have a choice to live or die. You know, and I think both of us made choices to live.
There were times all along that I thought I was catching on. Now I see it was only time catching up with me. As you stand at the door, I know I've never wanted you more. There's just one thing before you turn and you walk out on me. If this is the last kiss, if this is the last touch, if this is the last time I can ever be holding you, if this is the last embrace, can never forget your face. If this is the last kiss, I'll get used to it, I'll get through this somehow, some way.
Now reconciled to life as a former teen idol, in 1985 he made a brief pop comeback with The Last Kiss and Romance.
One night, romance.
Despite the millions of marriage proposals he'd received from fans, in reality, lasting romance was a stranger to David. His first two marriages ended in divorce.
I knew I had to move or I'd blow my chance to make sweet romance.
He only found happiness when he met his third wife, Sue Shiffrin.
My heart on fire. Romance.
I heal every day of my life with my son. All of my own relationship with my father. Everything, you know, my wife and friends of ours said, you know, have said to me, you really are a great father. And I learned how to be a great father by having my father, because everything he didn't do, I do. Every time I make a promise to him.
In the early 90s, in Blood Brothers on Broadway, where his father had once starred, David Cassidy again stepped back into the limelight.
I think Blood Brothers for him was a very, very important thing. More for him career-wise, more for me personally.
David wanted to be a straight actor. I mean, he didn't want to become a pop star. Although it brought him great fame and wealth, he almost resents it because the pop stardom stopped him from doing what he really wanted to do.
It is the most significant piece of work I have ever done, for me in many respects. It was an opportunity for me to come back. I'd never worked with my brother. I had to twist his arm to do it.
And it took him on a path that has taken him where he is now. And the show he's doing now is nothing like Blood Brothers, but still, it is a major deal up there, and it's a big success, and he's a grown-up.
The fact that David Cassidy became the biggest star in the world is an amazing thing. The fact that after it went away, he ended up on Broadway and winning an award and packing houses, doing it twice is amazing. And now he's the biggest draw in what could be considered, in a certain way, the show business capital of the world. The guy is phenomenally successful for the third time.
Step right up, come on in. There's a show that's about to begin.
I've been through a tremendous journey and learning experience, but I think the reason that I'm as successful as I am today is because the audience has connected with what I do.
Ladies and gentlemen, the star of events, David Cassidy.
People now make the comparison to Sinatra because it was his town and it was Elvis's town, and a lot of the media said to me, so you're the guy now. Yeah, Elvis, Sammy, Dean, Frank, and now me.
I am a clown, clown. You'll always see me smile. You'll never see me frown. Sometimes my scenes are good, but sometimes they're bad. Not funny, ha, ha, funny, sad.